the ideas in my head are starting to hook together. I'm doing that Charlie Munger lattice work of ideas, right? Of frameworks, of mental models. Things are starting to connect that I didn't realize when I picked up this book. If you do any higher order reading, you gotta take smart notes in Obsidian. I am currently reading The Geography of Genius, and I was telling a friend about it. You know, I'm taking all the concepts here, trying to analyze them, connect them to other things, taking notes, working with the ideas. And she said, but doesn't that take you a long time to read? And that's when I realized, right, reading fast, speed reading is what a lot of people are going after. And you want to be able to say, hey, I read 100 books this year. But what is the reason? Slow reading is so valuable if you actually want to understand the concepts, remember the concepts, apply them into your own life, right? You want to be able to analyze it, critique it, you know, even create your own ideas based on where you're reading in other people's ideas. So if you're into the second type of reading, then this video is for you. Let me show you what you can do in Obsidian and how it can enhance the way you think. Let me show you an example with this book I'm reading. So I'm only 2 chapters into this, but I felt so compelled to make this video because I felt so strongly about taking notes, processing your ideas. So in this video, I'll show you what you can do with Obsidian. I won't show you the technical details. If you're interested in that, you can check out this video. Now, let me start. This note looks empty, but actually it has ideas connected to it. This is graph view, and we are in the first level of depth. So that means these are the ideas that are directly from this book that I've pulled out. Now, there's maybe 10. So some of the ideas that are quite interesting: genius is created by culture. Genius clusters in cities like Athens, Florence, Hangzhou, Edinburgh, Calcutta, Vienna, and Silicon Valley. That's what this book talks about. And it says, it takes a village to raise a child, but it takes a city to raise a genius. I thought, oh, that's a new way of putting it. I didn't know that was how you would segment what makes a genius. So I put it down. Or here's another one I really liked. It says, many geniuses have done their best thinking while walking. And the ancient Greeks actually did not separate physical activities from mental activities. In Plato's Academy, it was very physical and very intellectual at the same time. This is a new insight for me. I definitely do feel from personal anecdotes that yes, I do have shower thoughts, walking thoughts that come when I make connections. But it was great to see it in this book, so I picked it up. Now, this is pretty basic, right? We're just getting ideas out. But now the magic starts to happen, where we start to make connections in the next level. So that's when we have the first idea and we start to think, oh, that's related to something else that I know. For example, let's take this one again. So the physical activity, thinking is not static. That the book jokes, Rodin's thinker is the ideal thinker for ancient Greeks because he's buff and he's contemplating about life. That linked me to Rodin, who also said that the mode of expression of men of genius differ as much as their souls. So all of a sudden, oh, random, but Rodin's fascinated with the idea of genius. You know, ancient Greeks also thought Rodin was kind of a genius. You know, okay, things start to connect. I don't know what's there yet, but I'm noticing something that I know of that I didn't know it before when I was just reading the book. There is another idea in the book about we're in an era of genius inflation. It seems like, you know, we throw the word around so easily. Oh, you're a genius. I'm a genius. We're all geniuses, which means no one is. And that to me is related to the idea of, so what makes a piece of art real? What makes a genius real? What are the essential elements you need to have? And now looking at the Rodin idea, I started to think, okay, to me, there's a connection between genius and a form of art. I don't yet know what's there, but to me, you know, it's almost geniuses are all kind of like an art form. Okay, well, I can explore this further. Again, you wouldn't be able to do that if you're just speed reading. So that's the second level of depth. Let's go one more. So see a few more connections as a result. So we start to see the idea and network expand. For example, let's come back to this genius thinking is not static idea. To me, it's also related to this idea of divergent thinking versus convergent thinking. Whether we are walking, whether we're having shower thoughts, it's about those moments where we can access the brain in a way that we can make new connections, neuroplasticity. So then from there, to me also, the other thing is That reminds me of a misconception that people have about framework thinking. People think that it's a very divergent way of thinking. You get to an answer. But to me, the power of framework thinking is actually in the framing of the question part. Right? Because you ask a great question, then you can get to a great answer. And actually, this reminds me that Einstein said if he had an hour to work on a hard problem, he would spend 55 minutes framing the problem. I should really put this in. Let me do that. If then, I think it was 55 minutes. Here we go. And now, just by this one connection, we all of a sudden have so many more things that we can explore. Okay, so the ideas in my head are starting to hook together. I'm doing that Charlie Munger lattice work of ideas, right? Of frameworks, of mental models. Things are starting to connect that I didn't realize when I picked up this book. How exciting is this, right? Just by adding one more connection, you have so many more things you can still start to work on. You can see the original ideas is such a different perspective. And you can tell I'm very passionate about this. Take it or leave it, and let me show you what you can do next. You can even go one level deeper at this point, right? And look at some of the other connections you might be making. For example, specialized generalist. I actually didn't realize what I really care about being a specialized generalist is the foundation of making a genius in my head. I didn't realize that though. Now I look at this graph and I start to think, okay, yes, if I read this book through that lens, I'm going to be able to find arguments maybe that support it or that disagree with it or give me a new way of phrasing this concept. Okay, that's cool. But of course, I don't even need to do that. I can just come back to the third level where you still see, I think about the specialized generalist and just take a look at what are the things I didn't realize about this book when I picked it up. When I picked it up, I just really liked the author's bio, which said he was a philosophical traveler. And I thought, my goodness, if only I knew this profession when I was in school, I aspire to be that at one point in my life. So, you know, didn't think much about it, but from just doing some of this more higher order processing, I started to realize I actually care about the topic of genius a lot. I care about the way they frame the questions. I care about the way that they don't make thinking static. I care about how it's connected to frameworks. I care about how it's connected to art. All of that I would not have been able to think about if I was just pulling out some of the interesting things the author said. So I'm getting really worked up here. Speed reading has its merits. Sure, of course, we're all busy. But really, if you want to get something out of the ideas, make it your own. Think about what you care about. What are the questions you want to answer? Then take some smart notes. You can get started with this video here, and I'll see you in the next video.